Hannah Clarke was born to Sue and Lloyd Clarke and grew up in Camp Hill, Queensland, along with her brother Nathaniel. Hannah was described as a bright, bubbly, and caring woman who was loved by her family. During her school years, Hannah was the school captain and was an accomplished athlete. When she was 16 years old, she represented Queensland for the trampoline gymnastics. Hannah competed in CrossFit competitions and worked as a fitness instructor at the PYCY. While working there, Hannah met Rowan Baxter. Hannah was 20 years old when she met Rowan, who was 11 years older than her. Rowan had trained with the New Zealand's National Rugby League team, the New Zealand Warriors. Growing up, Rowan had a troubled life and disrespected his mother. At the time he met Hannah, Rowan was working as a boxing instructor. He was married at the time and had a son with his wife. However, his relationship with his wife had soured and he was in the process of getting a divorce. When Hannah introduced Rowan to her parents, Sue and Lloyd had their reservations. Rowan at the time was living with his former partner in the same house, which he told Hannah's parents was purely for his child. In 2012, Hannah would marry Rowan and had their first child in April 2013, a baby girl whom they named Aaliyah. The couple would go on to have two more kids, Liana and Trey. Shortly after the marriage, Hannah's family and friends started to hear less and less from Hannah. Rowan had started to control Hannah's life. He would dictate what she was going to wear and whom she can meet. Hannah told one of her friends that Rowan wouldn't let her wear shorts or pink clothes as it would attract other men. He would not let her have her own Facebook profile and would want to know her location at all times. He would demand daily sex, and if she refused, he would stop talking to Hannah for days until he would get what he wanted. When Hannah was pregnant with Liana, she told her mother that Rowan had slammed the back gate on her, causing a bruise. The couple had opened up a gym together using funds provided by Hannah's parents and named it Integrate. Even though Hannah's parents had given the money to open up the gym, Rowan would treat Hannah's mother terribly. While assisting Sue during an exercise, Rowan accidentally let go of her, resulting in her face getting split open. He then laughed at her. Rowan would exhibit feelings of jealousy and anger towards his wife, even during training sessions if she outperformed him. He would try to diminish her accomplishments by making baseless accusations of cheating or not executing the routines correctly. He would berate her physical appearance in front of everyone, saying, "Look at your stomach, that's just disgusting. You need to lose weight and get back in shape." Rowan was also rough with his three children. In one incident, Rowan accidentally pushed Aaliyah into a door frame during a play fighting, causing an injury to her head. He would take the children to participate in post-workout ice baths with him, even though they hated every minute of it. He would post pictures of it on Facebook to attract more customers for his gym. Hannah's mother Sue said that her oldest granddaughter Aaliyah fought back against her father despite being afraid of him. She recounted how Aaliyah had once asked her father not to return home after witnessing him shouting at her mother. She said that while Liana and Trey would talk to Rowan on video and FaceTime calls, Aaliyah would sometimes refuse. Rowan would also have a hard time keeping clients as he would berate them, calling them fat, lazy, and pigs. Hannah would do most of the work and took care of the household expenses. She would take numerous classes at the gym, would look after the kids, and do all the household chores. Hannah would often talk to her friends inside her car, as Rowan would not allow her to talk to her friends or even her parents. Rowan would track Hannah's car, and once he had placed his phone inside her car to record her phone conversations with her friends. Her friends had told Hannah that she was in an abusive relationship. However, Hannah did not see it that way at that time, as she said that Rowan was not hitting her. In 2019, Hannah finally realized that she was in an abusive relationship and tried to leave several times. However, Rowan would manipulate her into staying by promising her to change and saying that it was best for the kids that they stayed together. In November of 2019, with the help of her friend, Hannah finally moved out of the house along with her kids while Rowan was at work. Hannah went to stay at a friend's house for a few days before she can figure out her next course of action. Rowan did not know this friend's house and he was furious. He called Hannah repeatedly and tried to manipulate her and told her that she was hurting the kids. Hannah would soon move into her parents' house along with her kids. In December 2019, Hannah sought help of the police and realized that she was a victim of coercive control. However, due to lack of evidence, a DVO could not be filed against Rowan. Additionally, Hannah wasn't interested in pursuing it at the time. Coercive control is an act or pattern of acts of assault, threats, humiliation, intimidation, or other abuse that is used to harm, punish, or frighten their victims. This controlling behavior is designed to make a person dependent by isolating them from support, exploiting them, depriving them of independence, and regulating their everyday behavior. Hannah attempted to shield her children from Rowan, but without a court order in effect, he still had legal rights to the children. On Boxing Day in 2019, Hannah took the kids to a local park and allowed Rowan to see the kids. Rowan asked Hannah if he could take the kids with him for the night. When Hannah refused, Rowan grabbed Eliana, threw her in the car, and took off. Rowan fled to New South Wales. Hannah was in complete shock and started to panic. Hannah called the police but was told that they could not do anything as there was no orders in place. In a body cam footage released by the police, you can hear Hannah panicking and explaining the situation. The police officers at the scene said, "Being the biological father, he does have the right to the children, and unfortunately, we can't just go and take the child." When police asked Hannah why she had not taken out DVO on Rowan, Hannah told them that she was afraid that a DVO would escalate the situation and result in retaliation. Rowan held Eliana for 4 days before returning her to Hannah. A protection order was finally issued by the police and Rowan was not to go within 100 meters from his children. Rowan would break this protection order several times and was able to get it changed so that he was allowed a temporary access to the kids. A temporary protection was issued which stated that Rowan was not to contact Hannah unless it was to contact the children or arrange a contact with the children. During a parental visit while Hannah was taking the kids out of Rowan's car, she saw photos of herself in her underwear. She tried to collect them all, but Rowan grabbed her wrist and twisted her arm behind her back. As a result of this, Rowan lost the access to the kids again.
So you've dropped the kids over, or picking them up from Hannah, and she's found some photos of her in your car, and then you've grabbed her on the arm. So that's basically the information we've got.
Despite a DVO was in place, Rowan would continue to contact Hannah and follow her. Hannah told her friends and family that she feared that Rowan would kill her. She was so scared that in February 2020, Hannah contacted her solicitor and created a will. She said if anything ever happened to her, she wanted to make sure her children were well looked after and went to the right people, her solicitor told Daily Mail. She had told the police her concerns and they had told her that things would be put in place to protect her. She had fears about what Baxter would do to her, but didn't think he would hurt the children. A week later, Rowan would murder his family. A day before the murder, a CCTV captured Rowan buying zip ties, a jerry can, 3 Kinder Surprises from a Bunnings warehouse. Rowan then filled the jerry can with 4.6 liters of fuel. The next day, on February 19th, 2020, Hannah got her kids dressed and ready for school. She got the kids buckled up in their seats and got inside the car. Just as she was starting the car, Rowan forced his way into the passenger seat. He had been hiding by a neighbor's house. In one hand, he had a jerry can and in the other, a knife. He held the knife to Hannah's throat and told her to drive. Hannah screamed and told him to get out of the car. Rowan demanded she drive. While she was driving, Rowan threw petrol on Hannah, the kids, and inside the car. and I drove approximately 200 meters and saw a man washing his car in his driveway at Raven Street in Camp Hill. She pulled over and cried to the man, "Call the police, call the police. He's trying to kill me. He has poured petrol on me." Rowan then immediately lit them all on fire. Rowan was restraining Hannah from getting out. Suddenly, the car exploded, and within seconds, the car was completely engulfed in flames. Hannah was able to get out of the car, but she was covered head to toe in flames. Hannah tried rolling around while the man desperately attempted to hose down the screaming mother. She was screaming that there were children still in the car. A passerby came over to help, but Rowan got out and prevented anyone from helping. Aaliyah, Liana, and Trey, who were strapped in the car's back seat, perished in the fire. Rowan then walked on the footpath, fell on his knees, and pointed the knife at his chest. He then fell forward on the knife before laying in a fetal position on his side. The fire brigade was able to put out the fire. Even though Hannah was covered in burns on 97% of her body, she was able to tell the first responders everything that had happened before she had to be sedated. She was rushed to the hospital but died a few hours later. During the inquest into the deaths of Hannah Clarke and her three children, Hannah's astounding bravery was acknowledged, and the coroner said Rowan Baxter was not mentally ill. He was a master of manipulation. I find it unlikely that any further action taken by police officers, service providers, friends or family members could have stopped Baxter from ultimately executing his murderous plans. Hannah's parents have since become outspoken advocates against DV and established the Small Steps for Hannah Foundation in their daughter's honor.